Will you join hands with your neighbor? Let us bow now our heads to our hearts. God of love and light, your spirit summons us here in grief and in gratitude for the life of your son, Dexter Scott King. Grant that we will all abide now in your presence. Feel the tender touch of your hand, reassuring us that you do all things well. Be with us all, but be especially with the King family, as they sit where all families must sit, at Jordan's stormy banks, its mist blowing in their faces as they watched yet another loved one cross over, their tears mingled with the mist of the Jordan. Be now with them. Be especially with Leah, as she must say with the psalmist, lover and friend have you taken far from me. Be with Martin and Bernice, who have had to say farewell to two parents and now two siblings. Dexter's daddy was right. Life, death. Death is not an aristocracy for some of the people, it is a democracy for all of the people. We come now face to face with what he called life's irreducible common denominator. Ask not for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee. Bless now the memory of this, our brother. We offer gratitude for his life, lover of music and the arts, purveyor of beauty and imagination, keeper of the dream. We bless the memory of this brother, born in the movement, named for the church where it all began, and now we come full circle. We are back at your house. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of storm, he shall hold you. Hold now our broken hearts. Even as our brother rises now to say to ancestors hello, we say to him goodbye. We'll see you in the morning. And this we do with blessed hope and a love that transcends the grave. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Liberator. Let the people of God say amen. Keep the faith, keep looking up.
Fall down, If you would introduce your family to us.
This is Dexter Scott.
And how old are you, Dexter?
7.
As a baby, Dexter, you were nurtured on the food of freedom. You were rocked to sleep in loving arms that reached out for justice through nonviolent direct action. As a baby, you were rocked to sleep to the rhythmic cadence of We Shall Overcome. You are today and tomorrow and for the rest of your life the recipient of a triple legacy. That our children are the arrows and we are the bows, from which our children as flying arrows must flee. And when we release the arrow from the bow, we have no ultimate control over where that arrow will land. For it is then caught up on the wings of the wind, impacted by the laws of the universe and by the grace of God.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I am so honored to be here. From our families to yours, we love you. We appreciate you all, and we're praying for you that the God of comfort will comfort you. We know that we serve a God who's faithful, even when we don't understand. Amen? The goodness of God. I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey, 'cause all my it's running after me. Your goodness, oh yeah, it keeps running after me. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing. God's been faithful.
All my life you have been so. Dexter Scott King, the youngest son of Coretta Scott King and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. An activist, a husband, a brother, a servant leader, board chairman and former CEO of the Martin Luther King Jr. Center for Nonviolent Social Change.
On the occasion of the installation of Dexter Scott King as second president of the Martin Luther King Jr. Center for Nonviolent Change, Incorporated, we're very happy and pleased that each of you have come to be with us and share this momentous and historic occasion. And so, with my fullest confidence, faith, and support, it is that I pass the torch of leadership to you. I remember the day, 2 years ago, when we sat down as a family and talked about the one who would assist and ultimately succeed mother. We all sort of sat uncomfortably in our chairs and looked away from ourselves to another. I can see Marty looking to Yoki saying, "Is you the one?" I could see Yoki looking to me saying, "Is you the one?" And I looked to you, Dexter, and I said, "Is you the one?" Well, Dexter, you is the one.
And Dexter was indeed the one. He was the one to take the reins from his mother and recruit more youth into the movement. He was the one to executive produce the first King holiday song that featured numerous R&B and hip-hop artists. Dexter Scott King was also the one to interview James Earl Ray, to collect information, and to look in his eyes and get answers about his father's assassination.
I just want to ask you for the record, did you kill my father?
No, I didn't. No.
I want you to know that I believe you and my family believes you.
He was also the one to discover the government's unethical involvement in Dr. King's life. Most of all, he was the one to protect his family's legacy.
We stand accused of profiteering by charging standard reprint fees and receiving royalties from my father's copyrighted speeches and essays and books. If that is profiteering, then every author who ever lived is guilty of the same crime.
You are irrevocably committed to making the King son of the West Point of nonviolence training.
When people ask, what does Dexter want? Dexter wants to serve. Dexter has to serve because the triple evils of poverty, racism, and violence are still among us.
And today, we need a new nonviolent army. An army that's mighty without missiles, real without rockets, brave without bullets, trained in living and loving and not in hating and killing. And this army needs young generals and young soldiers. You are the general in this army.
So to all of you young people out there who want to know about this nonviolent army, I have to tell you, I'm going to come to you, and I'm going to draft you. I'm going to be like Uncle Sam. I'm going to say the King Center wants you. Because what it's really all about is home. This is home for me. Uncle Joe, I've marched down Auburn Avenue. I'm home. Mother, 21 years ago, they slayed the dream. But But today, they must have forgotten that he had a son because the dream lives on. I'm home.
Praise the Lord. As Cece's already said, family, you know how much we love you and we are praying with you. And we thank you for your service. There's a song that I was asked to sing, and I believe that there is no mistake in this room that everyone that's born has a purpose and God has a destination for all of us. And with his help, we can do what he's called us to do. And we know in these times that God is still faithful. Why this is, we ask ourselves, down here on our knees, in the midst of tears, encourage yourself. He promised never to leave some wish upon a star in hope. One day that wish comes true. But I'm asking God with much regard, are the dreams you have are true? Born for this, destined for greatness, am I prepared for this? Your strength for my weakness, found that life's not always easy. Question if it's worth the risk. But down in my heart I can hear him say, you are born for this. Now what we don't know, time will tell. This I do believe. When a child is born, the angels sing in perfect harmony. That doesn't mean that's life or life. There's always room for rain. But if we know what autumn knows, spring will come again. And I'm born for this, destined for greatness. Yes, you are prepared for this. His strength for your weakness, found that life's not always easy. Question if it's worth the risk. But down in my heart, hear God whisper, yes, you were born for this. Now there's a time to live and a time to fly. So celebrate each moment of our lives. And if we ever lose our way because the heart is torn, never let it question why the reason you were. in my heart I hear God whisper, you are born for this. It may hurt sometimes, but you are born for this. Oh yes, we're born.
Is it enough whinings for you? My mother and father just kept having kids, you know. Bernice Martin, happy to be here, to the wife and to the family. Is that C sharp? You just want me to start? So often we pray, and I'm a firm believer that God hears our prayers. But he's still in charge. So let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. So let the church say amen. Everybody say, to what he said, everybody, God has spoken. So let the church say, make this your response to whatever he says, from the healing of the body to the rain the dead. Amen. No matter what you're feeling, amen, or how you're worded really, amen, battle all through the night, amen, cause you're gonna win the fight, amen, even in the valley, amen, standing at the Red Sea, amen, continue to say, amen, cause your help is on the way. Hey! One more time, let the church. spoken, so let the church say.
Why don't you wait in the water?
Why don't you wait in the water?
God's gonna trouble the water. because if you do not understand your history, because we're talking about America's history, then we are all doomed to repeat its mistake. And to reach out to young people all over the world is to have what will be a very exciting multimedia interactive experience that will actually transport people. For instance, a child who obviously could not have participated in the civil rights movement or marches, but could come and enter into this virtual reality experience. This is the only way to perpetuate this legacy and make sure that generations yet unborn will have an opportunity to understand what it was all about. So what I'm proposing is that we have an opportunity to not just have a static museum, something that you look at as if it's a page in history out of a history book, but to actually live the dream, to actually have a living memorial. This is the way we're talking about passing on my father's legacy. So I say to you and everyone who is here this evening, continue to carry on. Continue to be a family. Continue to build the community. Continue to serve others. But in God's name, please don't forget to help those who cannot help themselves. And I promise you, we will all get to the promised land.
This is everything. I want to begin by thanking God for this moment. And while it is a tremendously difficult moment for us, I want to try to reflect. First and foremost, this has been an amazing tribute. I hope I can share a little humor, knowing my brother for all his life. When we were young, very young, we had mini bikes. Dexter and I probably was 13, 14, and he might have been 11. And And one day, a policeman stopped us just for riding motorbikes. Back then, they would put you in the back of the paddy wagon and take you to juvenile. And when we got stopped, obviously, we were petrified. But Dexter always had sort of the gift of gab. And the policeman kept reaching down as if he was in a car, as if he was going to pick up his radio and call for the paddy wagon. I don't remember what Dexter said, but we went free that day. Now, there were many experiences like that. Dexter and Isaac and maybe Vernon would sit in the balcony across the street at Ebenezer. All of us were there. And when Granddaddy was preaching, he was very focused on his sermon, but he could see what his grandchildren were doing. Now, I wasn't talking, but Dexter and Isaac were cutting up. So after the sermon, Granddaddy calls them down, and he asks, Dexter and Isaac, I want you all to come down here for a minute and tell me what you deduced from my message. I was like, oh, they're in trouble. They're going to be in big trouble. Now, remind you, Dexter was smooth. And he said, very in a generic way, well, Granddaddy, you talked about love and forgiveness. And Isaac was slightly behind, almost as smooth. And I was shaking my head. I said, wow, he didn't get him. I thought he was going to get him. Now, much later on in life, I ran for county commission, Fulton County Commission, and was blessed to be able to serve for 7 years in this great community. And when we talked about it, Dexter and I, and Isaac ran our campaign, in fact, and Philip Madison Jones. It was Dexter and Philip Madison Jones who did the first fundraiser with the members of the Kennedy family. So the fact that they envisioned this major fundraising effort, I believe Jennifer Holliday was there as well. But it was Dexter's idea to say, hey, I want to show not just who you are, but I want to help. And so I remember all of these experiences. Now, you know, it is said that in our nation, as a democracy, we are trying to create a more perfect union. Sometimes in our lives, we are working to create a more perfect union. What maybe we represent is one thing, but we, the four of us, Yolanda, Dexter, Bernice, and I, experienced significant trauma at the loss of our dad. And that affected all of us in a different way. I don't know that you ever totally get over it, but you get through it. And we had amazing examples in our family that helped us. But we still have not achieved close to that perfect union. You know, I have a daughter. She's the only granddaughter of Martin Luther King and Coretta Scott King. And so, if you ever, first of all, we like every other family in a lot of ways. Some days we get along, some days we don't. That's called family. But see, what happens sometimes is somebody takes a side thinking they're supporting, and then family that seemed to be apart comes together. And then you left out there in the cold. So that's why you just kind of stay out of family stuff. Let the family work it out. In time, they'll do that. But at the end of the day, as I go to my seat, I want to thank Leah for being there, doing all of this time, and doing the time when Dexter was in great pain. So I thank you, Leah. We love you. And I'm saying to my sister, Bernice, that we will continue to work together to get it right. Because Yolanda and others in our family are going to continue to work for justice, righteousness, and truth. We will one day achieve what Mom and Dad talked about, the beloved community. We aren't even in the vicinity today, but we will get there. So I just want to appeal to all of you. Dexter, I know, has been welcomed home. Mom and Dad and Yolanda, Granddad and Big Mama, and my other grandfather and grandmother, Aunt Christine and Uncle Isaac, Aunt Edith, and the list of so many others there. He's run his race. Now it's up to us. Thank you, and God bless you, and thank you all for being here.
Thank you so much. Let me thank Pastor Warnock for opening up the doors of Ebenezer for us. And I want to thank BB and Cece, Marvin, and Stevie Wonder to come, and all of the musical guests. All of those that work to bring this together today, this evening. Before my sister Yolanda Denise King passed, she used to always call me and say, "This is your one and only sister." Afterwards, I picked up her phrase, and sometimes I would call Dexter and say, "This is your one and only sister." Well, to my one and only sibling who is left among the four, I love you. God got us. We've been through a lot together. As you said earlier, we lost a lot of family members, many tragically. But I remember what Granddaddy King used to always tell us, be thankful for what you have left. And I thank God for you. My one and only sibling. To my sister in love, Leah Weber King. You have shown me truly what it is to have the strength of a woman. This is a strong woman. God gifted you to my brother Dexter. And I thank you, as Martin already said, for your sacrifice, for your dedication, for your commitment. You are truly a ride or die. And I love you very much. And to the rest of my family, we're here again. We're just here in July to celebrate the life and legacy of our matriarch, Dr. Christine King Ferris. In the same sanctuary. We didn't know we would be back here again so soon, and especially to memorialize Dexter. And although it is still unbelievable and unreal, we don't grieve as those who have no hope, because we know to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Dexter is home, as you said, Martin. And I'm gonna take just a few moments, because there's a lot, as Martin said, that we could talk about. Stories of our growing up experiences. Of course, I could tell you about how Dexter as a child, as a young person, used to always tear things up like equipment, just pull it apart, and then put it back together. Didn't quite understand why he was doing that. He'd take his camera apart, put it back together, take his stereo equipment apart, put it back together, but something early on was developing in Dexter, a sense of inquisitiveness, a sense of curiosity. And I could tell you about how Martin and Dexter used to always want me to braid their hair, because back in the day they used to wear these big old afros, so they wanted their afros to look right. I can tell you about the time Martin and Alvita, you remember this too. Derek, I know you remember this. But at our house, and I understand it took place in Aunt Naomi's house and Uncle AD's house, Dexter used to always whine, why, mommy, why? I was like, Dexter, you too old to be saying that. Shut up. But why, mommy? Dexter wasn't satisfied with surface answers. Dexter was searching for something deeper, and that was the early seeds of him becoming a very analytical, brilliant person, a strategist par excellence. I could tell you, many of us can tell you, that Dexter could talk your ear off for hours, into the wee hours of the morning, till the sun came up. You took about 5 naps by that time. Dexter operated in his own timetable. He marched to the beat of a different drum. Dexter did not follow the pattern that it was set aside. He was on a different clock and a different rhythm. When we went to sleep at night, he was up. That's why he gained the nickname Count Dracula. Dexter was a true night hawk. I remember the time Dexter threatened to run away, and did run away. Told Mom, I'm running away. Martin told you we normal families. We faced a lot of trauma in our family, not just our father's assassination, but our uncle mysteriously found in his swimming pool he knew how to swim very well. We think it was tied into our father's assassination because he knew something. Our grandmother shot across the street at the Heritage Sanctuary of Ebenezer. So we went through a lot. Dexter ran away, and we were looking for him. Lord have mercy, Dexter had gone in the backyard in the doghouse. And boy, was he in the doghouse. Woo! But you know, my gosh, that was funny. Dexter, was a DJ. Saw that picture out there up here. He was a photographer. Isaac and him had K&F photography together now. They didn't always deliver your pictures on time. They were great photographers. In fact, Patricia Lattimore, who was my mother's personal assistant for years, she babysat me and Dexter in particular. Martin, I think you're a little bit more, much older. Not much older. You're not that much older. But she's here today. They took the pictures for her wedding. And I had the nerve to want to shadow my brother, be just like him. I ended up DJing for a stint and doing photography for a stint. We just had a wonderful childhood. And as we grew up, we all went in our own different ways, but we still had a foundation of love. Mother taught us not just about love, she embodied it. I remember she used to tell us, Martin, I don't hold grudges. And we knew she didn't hold grudges because things happened to her, and we watched how she still extended herself to people nonetheless. We had an example of love, forgiveness. And as we went in our own ways, we remember our mother telling us, you don't have to be your mom. You don't have to be me. You don't have to be your daddy. Just be your best self. And as I look at all of our lives, Dexter, Martin, Yolanda, the two who are no longer with us, and myself, I think we've done a good job of being our best self. Yeah. You try to be the children of two great parents, not just one, but two. I dare you, try to be it. I think we've done a good job. And as Martin said, we had conflict. You all knew about the conflict. Let's just deal with the elephant in the room. We had some conflict, but not the kind that would separate us in terms of our deep love for one another. I remember the Holy Spirit telling me that your parents lived through a movement and displayed what it means to practice nonviolence. And the Holy Spirit said, y'all don't have a personal example. And he told me that even though you are conflicted right now, as siblings, it's displaying something before the public because, yes, in the beloved community, there's even conflict, but it's how you work out the conflict that matters. And when you're grounded in nonviolence, you go through a process. It's not easy. It's not automatic. It doesn't happen immediately. And within the beloved community, the engine is reconciliation. And so the Holy Spirit said to me distinctly when we were on different sides of this conflict that we were having that he was going to do something to reconcile, especially me and Dexter, and prove it to the public that nonviolence does work. And so in the last 10 months, Dexter and I had a wonderful opportunity to reconcile our differences, to forgive one another, to pour into each other, to say how much we love each other, to say how proud we are of each other, to say how much we respect each other. And I thank God because I prayed for this a long time. I prayed on altars for reconciliation. Constantly praying. God bring, I don't know how, bring it back together. God finally told me one day, this battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. So from that point on, I decided to give it to God and go to sleep. And so, as I come to an end, Dexter Scott King, I want you to know, is a brother just like my other brother who I love dearly. Just because he's gone doesn't mean I don't still love him. I love him dearly. Yes, he was very misunderstood. Many people in this audience misunderstood him. We criticized him. We didn't understand that this was a man early on developing the knacking for seeing far distances. He had an instinct in him to know that certain things needed to be done in a certain timetable, and that's why he was endeavoring to create something in 1995 to 1997 that we would be the benefactors of, called the Dream Center. But the people did not understand it and viciously criticized him. He was before his time. Now we're in a technological age and everybody's got some kind of museum with technology and innovation. Well, we're gonna still bring it back home, y'all. We're going to fulfill Dexter's dream in this city with Dr. King. That's Dexter Scott King's legacy. He will live just because he's no longer with us. They didn't understand he was pioneering. He was opening up doors for other people, intellectual property doors. I remember Bud Smith, I don't want to call you out, but Bud Smith came to me one day and he said, I just want to thank you all for what you did with the King Papers. He said, because of what you all did, you created value for Black history. Nobody would even consider putting value on our photographs if you all hadn't sold your papers. Y'all may have not understood, but Dexter was helping us to pioneer and opening up doors for people, so that they too could build generational wealth. Dexter was ahead of his time. He had hawk eyes and he had hawk instinct. Yeah, January 24th, over at the King Center, there's a sign in front of the crypt. There was a hawk perched up on the sign. Security guard took a picture of it, I saw it, and then hawk shifted to the island where my parents are entombed. I shared it with Leah and she said, oh my God, that's Dexter's favorite bird. Dexter came home, watching over things, using the intelligence, wisdom, and signifying, I understand, hawks signify change. So as I go to my seat, I said that about three times because I'm a preacher. In case you didn't know it, yeah, I'm the CEO of the King Center, but I'm still Reverend Bernice A. King. Don't get it twisted. Give it to God, y'all. Work on the reconciliation. I don't know who's in here and needs to hear that. But we still got some reconciling to do. It ain't easy work. Things have to be restored. It's not saying let bygones be bygones. There's restoration in it. There's healing in it. It's work. We worked over the last 10 months. And I thank God he chose to do that because I needed that. And as we approached Christmas, I decided to send what was over my bed as a canvas that says, give it to God and go to sleep. I sent it to Lee and Dexter. These last few days, Dexter was laser focused, wasn't sleeping much. I'm sure she may talk about that. But that sign was saying something, because Dexter was a fighter all his life. Sign was saying, it's now time to give it to God and go to sleep. When he finished his assignment, Leah said he started sleeping for a few days. And he slept until he slept into the arms of God. So Dex, you fought a good fight. You finished the race, my brother. You kept the faith. And now there is in store for you the crown of righteousness. Dexter Scott King, you really got your crown as a king now. I love you.
First Corinthians 13:4 speaks of love this way. It says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. As I stand before you today, I am so thankful to have loved and to have been loved by Dexter Scott King, my beautiful husband. When I decided that I would in fact speak here today, I struggled with how I would capture all that he was, not only to me, but to his family, to my family, to his friends, to his loved ones, to the beautiful city of Atlanta, as well as the global community. But after much thought and some trepidation, I settled upon the fact that speaking directly to him about our love and our journey together would probably provide the clearest picture of who Dexter was as a man, as a husband, as a brother, a beautiful man that I am so proud to have called my husband, my beautiful angel, Dexter. I don't think either one of us could have imagined that on a fateful night in spring of 2003 in the beautiful hometown of New Orleans, Louisiana, I would cross paths with the man that would change my life forever. I can remember that day so clearly. You agreed to share excerpts of your new memoir, Growing Up King, at my recently opened coffee and espresso bar. You walked in quietly and powerfully, instantly catching my eye. We were both guarded at first, reserved, skeptical of the other. But there was a pull that existed between the two of us. Neither you or I could deny. It was a powerful force, kismet even. We danced our dance, slowly and methodically, circling each other carefully for months while protecting our hearts from what we were certain would include some disappointed and perhaps some heartbreak. But our love was patient. We were patient with each other. We allowed each other the space and the time to discover what these new feelings were all about. It was during this time that I began to notice all that lied beneath the stoic exterior you presented. You remained cautious, yes. But over time, cracks began to form in your rigid outer covering. And the warmth of your beautiful heart began to shine through, shining bigger and brighter with every passing day. Tragedy had shaped your armor, but underneath it was the kindest, most gentle man I have ever known. With time and through the grace and kindness of our love, we were afforded an opportunity to meet each other at our core level, building a soul connection that would last until death do us part. Only because our love was kind. Our journey was a private one. We lived our life with few outside distractions. We could have sought the validation of others or put our relationship on center stage for all to see, but love does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. You, my love, were born a king, beautifully sculpted with the physical traits and intellect of the most revered and impactful man of our time, your beloved father. In addition to that, you held the grace, talent, and steadfastness of your beautiful mother. Most men would have capitalized on this for all the riches that it could bring, drowning themselves in constant affirmation, attention, and power. You were blessed with abundant wisdom, knowledge, and strength. You were indeed what most would consider, and what I considered, a man who had it all. But instead of devoting your life to how these riches could advance your personal aspirations and fuel your ego, you devoted your life to how all of these riches could advance the cause and legacy of your father, your mother, and your family. Your efforts were not always met with praise or seen clearly by others. Your vision was often met with disagreements, challenges, and yes, sometimes conflict. You could have retaliated. You could have held grudges and rejected opportunities for forgiveness. But love does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It's not easily angered, and it keeps no record of wrongs. One of the most selfless and forgiving acts of your time on this earth was when you joined your mother and siblings in hearing out the individual accused of taking your father's life, killing the dreamer. He was one of the most hated men of the century. Your seven-year-old eyes forever captured the images presented at that time. But because of your relentless pursuit of the truth, your courage, and your bravery, alongside your mother, you woke tirelessly to right one of the most horrific wrongs of our lifetime. Thank you for your persistence and your consistency, even in the face of criticism. Months were spent giving grace and offering understanding. Many disagreed with you on this approach. But again, love does not delight in evil. It rejoices in the truth. Thank you for trusting me, for trusting God with our future. Early on in our sweet journey of intertwining hearts, we quickly realized that our relationship was one of a divine plan, not in our hands, but in the hands of our Holy Father. Upon our acceptance of this, our love and lifelong devotion to one another became our only goal. It was after 11 years of loving, learning, listening, and leaning, we said, I do. Thank you for protecting me and fighting for the protection of your family and its legacy. We would not be where we are today without your love. A love that always protects, always trusts. In this game of life, you were not dealt the easiest of hands. At an early age, your life dictated that you become comfortable with hatred and the evils of the world. Tragedies abound. News of your father's assassination with a breaking news banner flashing across the television screen. Your eyes and your heart had to endure that. Your grandmother gunned down as she played the organ in the church. Your eyes, your heart had to endure that. Other loved ones lost way too soon. Your eyes, your heart had to endure that. What would surely have made any average man crumble, you remain hopeful and clear-eyed about a better tomorrow for all of us. Why? Because love always hopes. Even when faced with the unthinkable just 3.5 short years ago, you never stopped seeking a way to overcome. Your bravery and your courage was inspiring. Thank you for your commitment, your fight, your focus. You showed me that even in the darkest of times, love always perseveres. Through your challenges, you worked on a vision forward. Your laser focus left us with a clear mission, a way into the future. Thank you for challenging us to dream bigger and wider, illuminating a path forward for all who want to become a part of this Kingian nonviolent revolution, this love army. Though you're no longer physically present, your spirit remains. We will use your flame to light others. We will take up your charge to continue building the beloved community. We will continue to reach forward to educate the next generation on Kingian methods of resolving conflicts. We will continue to love each other. We will continue to build each other up. We will continue to aspire to be our best selves. And we will continue to light other candles along the way. We will overcome. This is my solemn vow. So as you look down and see here that each of us are symbolizing the light of your love tonight with a single glow in our hands, let the collective illumination remind you that you are loved, you are honored, and missed by all of us. Lay down your burdens now, my beauty. Job well done. Spread your wings and fly into loving arms of our Father, your parents, your sister, and all of our heavenly angels waiting to receive you. Watch over us, continue to guide us and protect us, I love you dearly, Dexter. My heart will forever be yours. Now you rest well until we meet again.
No, there was no question he looked most like his father. He even talked like his father.
I'm just beginning to take up the fight for justice. And if the newspaper thinks that the King children have lost their father's spirit, then it is blind to the contributions made by my brother Martin III and Sister Yolanda in public service, and obviously have never witnessed the Reverend Bernice King at the pulpit. She is her father's daughter in every sense of the word, spirit.
I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
Along with them I'll bide, and they won't Pigmen feeling small, weak and standing tall. I will watch them fall. They won't know when I go.
My God, what a night. My God, what a God we serve.